started, just place a few shapes in, positive and negative shape.
I'm going there and I'm making my measurement, whether it's a cheekbone, his shoulder there, I'd go, okay, here we go, it's like that.
I call that transferred angles.
Yeah, I loosely call it triangulation, but yes, it's a, it is that. Okay.
You know, but you're the only other person I've seen do that other than me. Teach transferred angles like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You only need 12 spots that are dead accurate. Yeah. And then it starts getting, you can't make the huge mistakes.
I'm sure there's probably some other guy out there that does it. You're the only other one I know of, David.
Yeah, Paul Davis and I are.
Yeah, it's good to know.
I'll show you this book that I used.
So much for tightening that.
Now, I'm removing some paint. Just enough. Now I'm going to paint some light on here.
Don't mind the guy behind the curtain here.
No. You need to stick a, what I would do with these often at the art up at the school when he had them is we drill, take an eighth inch drill bit and take a finish nail and clip it off and then stick the pointy part down and jam it up in there. So now this little, two little points would go dink, like bangs into the canvas. Okay, now one of my inexpensive brushes. I have about 2,000 brushes now. I've got a plan. Now, I used to never mix on the canvas. Nah, sometimes you have to. It's practical. But I don't mix on the canvas. I don't use black. I don't blaze with white. I follow all the rules that this beginning painting book found me, but I don't have any result. Okay, so now I'm gonna take titanium white, two colors I need, and I'm gonna pick up a little bit of this pigment. Okay, now in this can here, I have some liquid.
Spray. Okay, spray, sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay. I'll get by without it. But now I'm trying to paint. I'm going to say, okay, generally this thing, no, that's okay. Generally this thing has light in certain areas. So I'm going to grab this light and put it on. Now you realize that there's liquid on this surface, and I'm brushing it into that liquid. Mm-hmm. And I have a little bit of time to get it set. Something there and decide whether I want it or I don't. Okay. Then I'll take a card. I was out, we were out landscape painting one day, and this kid says, I always get to the power lines and I can't paint. I said, do you want to see how to do it? And he said, yeah. His name's Rob Adamson. He's a teacher at Salt Lake Community College now. And called me, nicest guy. He called me one day out of the blue. I hadn't heard from him for 15 years. He said, I wanted to thank you for being one of my teachers. Nice guy. I was like, well, thanks, Rob. You know. So now I've got some white pigment on here. This is a great applicator for paint. I come up, and I can say, okay, here's the table edge, and I carefully set that on. Now I can tear it to any width I want. top edge of this form would have a line along this edge, a line up here of the area right there, another area here that's light, a plane down here that's light, but I can curve it. It's going to get light, so I'll sit there and I'll get this vertical and I'll go, okay, here's right in there. Okay, now it is too long, not a problem. I'll just pick that back up. Okay, now I'm going to place my shield out again. Magic of it is put some marks down, you know, and then it'll start suggesting what it could be. I'll take a brush, probably no liquid, there is some liquid on the surface, and I'm going to say, where are the highlights on this object going to be? Thinking the light is here. Screw head here, probably an edge here. Notice everything is moving in a horizontal or vertical manner here. Right below that. So as my brain performs, I'm going, there's no rush to get this down. I'm going, it's over from there. It's looking back over here. Finally say, drop it a little bit, and I put my mark there. The amateur says, you know, I need dab, 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 paint on the painting. The professional goes, spends a lot of time here, gets it loaded, comes up, looks and says, okay, that's gotta be, I can move it up, down, I'm steadying my hand, looks at everything and say, boink, that's all it takes to paint. Got to make that be in contact with your canvas 5% of the time instead of 90. Now there are some things on here. Every once in a while, you know, there'd be some kind of something in the, you know, you look in a shop and then there's some kind of a weird, you know, wire or something back there, a band of something. Take my here. Come through, bang, knock the paint off of it, pull any high spots of oil paint off. Going every direction. So it starts to appear. I'm looking through a shower door. Now notice I'm banging this down here. I'm getting that paint off of there so that I'm not really, it's not really mushy. But if I go through that two or three times, notice how this form looks similar to that, but it's receding and it's going back in space. Now, my brief moment of paint, for you to say, I want to warm this thing up just a little bit. So I'm going to take that gray. Be all I spray, and now I've laid that out. I might even then come back in and go back in and touch my highlights again. Now I can make corrections here. I can move it over a little bit, back, spot. Notice how you turn your brush. If you're holding your brush like this, that's for your checkbook. It's almost like even to the smallest brush stroke, get your brush out here. Let it be just this little
hold its direction. So, you're saying, okay, here's this thing, I'm back, mark, shape, touch, boom. Oftentimes that's all I'll do on a painting. Then now it's time to bring another one up that's a little further along. And this has got a lot of serendipitous marks on it. It doesn't mean this one, I might go back in and I say, what, this needs to feel more like an old garage. So I'll take a thin, some liquid and some thin phthalo green and burnt sienna, mix them together and make a sort of asphaltum color, and I'll fling it on there, and then I'll spray it with retouch and it'll drip and it'll start feeling like oil in an old garage. Whereas I can't, I can't sit there and go, okay, to make all, you know, I'm now interested in the, look at the history of that, how gravity affects it. I got some blue on there, but, okay. So now here's something here that suggests energy. Oh, I can't. Oh, that's a problem. Okay.
You got it.
Yeah.
It's on there pretty tight.
Now we've got the baby tied too. So now, how did this painting start? I went in the first day, I had some carmine red graffiti paint, and I painted the background red, and I put a band across here and painted that gray. I have probably 20 canvases in just that state. Then one day when I was into the day, I was cleaning my brush, I just went, okay, let's get something up. Boom, and boom, and boom with white. Okay, now, I used to paint with a lot of stencils, and I'd come in, I'd say, take the time, and I'd come in and take a compass and draw, and then I'd cut these things out and make a shape, because I wanted a round shape. Or when I need to paint the edge of a flower or something like that, I can tear, and I can lay the paint in, and I can imitate the shape and kind of bend it in the shape of the edge of a flower, much more efficient than, you know, trying to use a brush all the time. I thought, want to see how to paint power lines? And he said, yeah. I said, well, I grabbed, I said, give me your card. And he took, I just took a little, I took his canvas, and it was actually some black, but I'll use white so you can see the purposes. That's a parabolic curve, you know, you take a brush like this, it's like, so. Little moment, I just said, okay, now look at there and look at your power pole, bend your card. Sorry, I'm
gonna put on this one. You want me to hold it?
Here. Yeah, just hold it up there for a second. So there's the top of one pole, there's the other, and bend it, boom, touch down, and it was as delicate as a line can be. You look at, go online and look at Rob Adamson's paintings now at Salt Lake Community College, and you'll see he takes this card and he uses it everywhere. He paints mountains with it. It's got all these energy lines. It's like, okay. Then, if I can see that just for 1 second, what I can do is say, I want this to go back in space. So, is this closer to me or is that? If this end is closer to me, I'll kind of leave that and I'll push this into the surface. Start dragging. These are my only clean pants. I just bang, bang. Bad habits. But I'll start banging that in. You start seeing that starts to go away visually in space. And yes, they are tricks. They are efficiency tricks. I know as many as anyone I've ever seen. Because there is the nuance that I'm after. And I get this painting somewhere so I can react. As a teacher, it's really nice because students have done all the work trying to get this life drawing going. And you can come up as a teacher and you can go, oh yeah, here, and just like boink and then dink and dink, whoa, and it brings, you're doing all that, you know, you got the road grader out there. We get to come in and lay the bathroom tile. It's kind of fun.
So I don't want this part process to be very long. And as I said, I used to take combinations of cards, I'd cut circles, I'd cut, eventually now I've gone to where I have a computer that cuts the shapes for me, I draw the shapes, I design them, the jars I want, and I come up with, I have a, somewhere around 4,000 to 5,000 of these, a jar.
What kind of paper are you cutting into, David?
What is this, Mary Lou?
It's like,
don't ask me these difficult questions.
Cardstock or something?
Yeah, it's a thin cardstock.
Yeah.
Okay.
I found that's just about right.
To think of a cardstock gives you the, just.
Yeah, there's cheap, $300. You can put it onto your computer and it'll cut these shapes for you.
The machine's a silhouette.
It's called a silhouette. It's better than the Cricut.
A lot of crafters use it.
Okay. Again, it's an ultimate trick. And your painting will look like it. It's all a trick until you, if you don't work from life. I think I didn't complete my thought yesterday in drawing, but the one thing that got me in my career more doors open was my ability to draw the figure. And draw it quickly. Anyway, so now I've got a series of them. So you can see that I have on this scale, and probably about 11 of these. So I'll be talking, I'll be painting, literally, and I say, Kate, give me Roundy Neck, all of these nicknames, Roundy Neck or Chemistry.
She give them names.
Yeah, just so she knows, and I say, nope, scale down, I'll hand it back to her. And we've got these baker's carts. You saw those in the photos last night, and they're full of, there's a little black and white silhouette on each column that'll show this little picture, and she'll go over there and scan, and so vases are in one place, you know. It's really quite an efficient thing. So as I'm painting, I need something like this, and we'll do this one here. I'm going to spray, this is a custom color. Come in here and say, okay, I want to see what. Shape of an edge. Here's a painting. One right in here. Just something there. Here's that thin red. Once in a while, you've got to do something. Okay. Keeps you reacting.
Automatism.
Huh?
Automatism.
Yes, absolutely. I know where this started once. Eberhard Eggers, a German artist, was at graduate school. And it was real hot painting the studio with no shirt on. And he said, you want to, David, let's go get some lunch. I said, okay. So I had just painted this phthalo green background field with all these things. We went to lunch and I left the paint a little too thick on it, just went whoosh over the painting, and I got back and I went, oh, and I started to remove it. I said, oh, wait, just remove a little bit. So now you can see that painting, and it's like, you see the paint going through that surface. I couldn't tolerate that before. This is a 25% three-touch varnish, and it's a brown. Is this an enclosed air system you've got here,
yeah,
or is it exit?
It should be exit.
There's an exchange.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
None of this is toxic that I'm using. I'm specifically not using the toxic things. But.
Well, you're not spraying cadmium.
No, it doesn't affect you.
Yeah.
Okay. No, there's no cats here. And you can do it actually in a classroom situation. You can do, what works well is things like
black shoe polish. You know, the kind that's liquid, and yeah, that's cheap. It's not like India ink. It's good stuff. Paint with some black shoe polish and some typewriter ribbon, like I talked about. Great, great. Okay, so.
I saw a guy one time use roofing tar.
Yeah.
Black. He took roofing tar and put some like thing, like some oil gel and stuff inside of it, and he used that as his black. I was like, that's awesome.
You know, William de Kooning, to get his strokes, paint strokes, would use water in oil paint, because the water would serve as a resistance in some areas. Ooh. And it would just, you know, play. I mean, I'm a mad scientist in a lot of ways. I play a lot of it, So the actual color that is that I'm putting on is one of my favorites. It's burnt sienna, which is kind of a red, and phthalo green. Those are two transparent colors mixed together in the right combination, make a color that's very permanent, but rather like asphaltum, almost like a Rembrandt's color.
Yeah, those 19th century painters who use asphaltum, that's been flaking off on them.
Yeah.
Asphalt's not a good idea.
Well, Julian Schnabel ended up going around the country pasting his plates back on those paintings
that
were,
right?
You know, $100,000,
$200,000, $300,000. Wasn't he like Bondo or something? He was gluing his plates on with Bondo?
Yeah.
That's a card.
I think that's hilarious.
Filler, I think, yeah.
He deserves it. Those paintings were such junk. Boy, was he.
I never liked that Schnabel either.
Well, it was Schnabel. I went to a show of his at Mary Boone in New York, and I thought, if this guy was in beginning drawing class, art major, he would probably get about a C or a C minus. Anyway, so oftentimes I like that shape there, but I'll have a smaller lid. I'm gonna push this down with the shield on.
It's a great idea to have a positive and a negative shape on those. I think that's nice.
Yeah, yeah. We'll put a negative in blue. Boom.
That's blue.
That's blue. I want to kill the blueness of it. I'll take this pigment with retouch varnish. I want to knock that blue back. Said sometimes, you know, this more arbitrary serendipitous stuff is something I'll use, and sometimes it's here's what I like sometimes with a it's something unlike that, but you want some kind of a decorative base. Let me pick that up. Now I can make that look like the jar is stuffed with something. Just arbitrary stuff happening. Take a few days, take a week, and play with application. Unusual materials, tools, things like that. And every once in a while, it'll apply perfectly to painting. Okay. Now, Daniel Sprague, a friend of mine, like I say, he uses a thing. They even have these. You can put, this is what I put sometimes, I'll take these caps off. They're like 69 cents, right? Mm-hmm. I always had a philosophy, is if I get a stitch, need some stitches, why can't I just go to the veterinarian and get two stitches in my finger where I know I need them, and he'll put them in and it'll be safe and everything? No, you gotta go to the emergency room, and it's $468. The vet's 28 for our dog.
Wow.
But, so, you know what a syringe costs in a hospital versus Intermountain Farmers.
It's Cal Ranch around here, you guys.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I bought those needles to do furniture repair, even, you know, put glue in.
Yeah. Just so, right.
Shove it into the wood, the veneer, you know.
So, liquid. A little bit of thinner to take the viscosity down.
decrease the viscosity. And then just a kind of a liquid, a little bit more. I want that plane of the table to go just a pinch higher in value. Some of that red will show through. Retouch and wipe. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll set this up. An artist named Eric Fischel, as I look back, he would do a lot of figure sketches. Do you know Eric Fischel?
Yeah.
Run across his work, you'll see it. And Eric Fischel would do a lot of figure sketches. Somebody called him the Sergeant of Modern Day, and I thought this historian is up to sleep up at night. You know, like, are you kidding me? Oh, what are you talking about? But he did make some interesting paintings that were very socially relevant. Anyway, Eric Fischel would take a graphite and rubbing alcohol, and he would draw on glassine, which is a transparent paper. Just do fast sketches of models like this. And then he would tape them onto the wall and move them around, and that's how he would compose his paintings. Well, that's what I'm doing a little bit more, so I have usually a big painting. You realize I have some of these jars that are like this size, so I'm looking up at the mirror and I'll set this up here. And I'll go, no, over here. A painting this size, I can see almost the whole thing in one shot. So I don't look at the mirror quite so much, but in the bigger paintings, you're right here, you can't see the gestalt. So over here, I want the viewer's eye to go over here, but I want the height to be something like this. So let's get to the 25% wash. I want that side just to be a. Okay. I'm going to have my. Mall stick, okay, the tabletop edge. Use this bottom edge. Decorative filigree here. Okay, I make my own retouch now. Can it? Instead of $9, it's getting to be $11 and $12 in some art supply stores. It's about $3.50. Do you use retouch? Probably not too much in.
No, I don't.
Yeah, I do it. Use it daily, and I have for when I'm doing large paintings, I have a small sprayer from Home Depot, and it's got retouch in it permanently.
When I work abstract, I use acrylic more. Yeah, that's what I use as acrylic. I don't use oil for my more abstract stuff.
Then I have a little bit of. Okay, so let's put a little. Okay, now, here's the magic. You should never be able to, every once in a while these get clogged up. Some will clog up more than others. There's a little cup here with tape on top of it.
There's this.
There's a cup with tape.